Morning, everyone. My name is Rahul Belani. I'm the VP of products at JSTOR. And I'd like to spend the next 15, 20 minutes talking and sharing with you programs that we've developed to provide access to individuals who are not affiliated with institutions, because JSTOR provides access to their content to users that are affiliated with institutions. And the programs we've developed on top of that are for people that don't have access and cannot get access through their affiliation with institutions. Before I do that, very quickly run through a little bit of recap of history of JSTOR for those of you that might not be all familiar with it. We were created back in 1995, and our intention was to help librarians and libraries deal with cost issues related to shelf space. Libraries were hosting and holding all backruns of journals, and this was taking up a lot of space. We wanted to work with them to address that challenge. We worked with publishers to go back and digitize all the back files, full runs of all the back files that were on these shelves, and make all of that content available online for users to access. Once all this content was made available for access to the users, the librarians could then take that space and reclaim that space and repurpose it for other things. We launched the JSTOR platform in 1997, and by platform I mean that was the service through which users could come in and access information and access content. We launched that with all these journal back files back in 1997, and since then we have added some current journals, we've added books, we've added primary sources, and we continue to keep adding more content into our JSTOR repository. A little bit about our mission. It might seem that we have changed a lot over the years, but we still remain very close to our mission, which is to expand access to scholarly content while preserving the academic record. So we do this by working very closely with our users, understanding their needs, understanding what is of most value to them, and then developing solutions that best serve that need for our users. We also, in doing so, we also help publishers who share their mission of expanding knowledge and expanding accessibility to their content across the user community. So we help publishers as well. Over the past 20 years since our platform has been live, we've been pretty successful in sticking to our mission and accomplishing our mission goals. We've built our reputation by really providing high quality digitized content to our users. Today we have over 10,000 institutions worldwide that participate in the JSTOR program. And in the repository we have content from over 1,200 publishers that represent over 2,000 archival journals, 50,000 books, and research reports. And like I said, we keep adding more and more content into these repositories. Last year we had about 175 million accesses of content on our site, so users coming to our site and getting a downloaded document or whatever, it was about 175 million of those. Our business model, pricing model, is very flexible to encourage very wide participation. So if you're a very small institution somewhere that cannot afford a big price tag, we have a different pricing structure and a different pricing model compared to a big institution that has the resources and the funds to support us. So our goal is to expand as much access and availability, and it's not driven by pricing, and we sort of make that available widely. Access to JSTOR traditionally has been through your institution. We make it very simple for people to access JSTOR. If you are affiliated with an institution and if you are within the institution's campus, you don't have to log in, you don't have to do anything, you just go straight in and you start using JSTOR. But we found and we heard from people that were researchers that were not affiliated with institutions, and they wanted access to JSTOR as well. So that's why we developed these programs to give them access, even though they are not affiliated with any institutions. There are four programs over the years that we've developed. I'll talk about the Register and Read and the JPass program in detail at the rest of the slide. I mean, the rest of this presentation. This slide over here is the page that somebody gets if you're not affiliated with an institution. So you do a search on JSTOR, you find something you're looking for, let's say it's this article, it gives you information about that article, and then it gives you these little options to access those articles. You can do it either for free for read-only online, and that's the Register and Read program. I'll talk to you about that in a second. You can subscribe to it for $9.99 a month, and that's the JPass program, and again, I'll go a little bit deeper into that. Or you can download just that one article for $11. And that's the publisher service that we have. That price is set by the publishers, and they decide, so every article has a different price over there. And the publisher decides what price to put on there, and we just are the platform through which the user pays that price and gets the content. And it's really a publisher service, and it helps the publisher sort of get more content out there. So that's the page that sort of people get when they're not a subscriber to JSTOR. The first program I'll talk about is the Register and Read program. This one was introduced back in March of 2012. It's a very, very simple program. We have something called MyJSTOR. You come to the site, you create an account for free for MyJSTOR, and as soon as you do that, you have access to 3 articles every 2 weeks for free. That's it. I mean, it's simple. There's nothing more than that, nothing less than that, and that's what you get. What you don't get is downloading privileges or printing privileges. So you cannot download or print an article, but you can view 3 articles every 2 weeks on the screen. How is this program doing so far? So in the first 3 quarters of 17, we have about 1,900 journals that participate in this program. So almost all of the JSTOR repository journals are participating in this program. We've had about 1.6 million people use this program, and more than 4 million articles have been viewed through this program. So it's been a pretty successful program. Year over year, we've seen a 5% growth in this program. And a lot of people come back to it. So we track how people are using it, how much people are using it, and we've seen a significant portion of people coming back to it. So that's a good sign. So the value, like I said, is really this program is available to anybody. As you remember, I said this was a program for people not affiliated with their institution. So they don't need to be anywhere around the institution. They can be at home. They can be doing research anywhere else. They don't need to be affiliated with an institution. They get access to this for the scope of the content, over 60 different disciplines, 1,900 journals. So it is the wide breadth of content that they get available for their use. The downside, though, is this, what I just mentioned, which is limited access. Only 3 articles every 2 weeks, and you cannot download or you cannot print. So to address that, we developed another program called JPass, which is an annual or a monthly subscription for a fee where you can come in, and that gives you unlimited reading, so that limit of 3 articles a month every 2 weeks and all that stuff is gone. And you get a fixed number of downloads every month or every year, and that's a big number where we've seen that people rarely hit that number. So we've given them that flexibility of number of downloads and number of views through this program. What we've also found is that giving access to people is not enough by itself. We also have found that people want some tools. So we've started to develop some basic tools, things like cite this item or create a list. If you're doing a research, you can create a list of articles based on the research topic that you're doing. And then you can take those articles and create an outline. So you may be doing a paper, and that outline can help you get started on your paper. So these are some of the very basic tools that we've created, and this all came about in our conversations with users, asking them what would you like to see on our site apart from just getting access to the content. And these were sort of the immediate things we heard, and we've developed those kinds of things. As far as how is JPass doing, again, for the first 3 quarters, we've got almost everybody in our archival journal content participating in there. On any given day, we have about 4,000 active subscribers. And I say 4,000 because it's a monthly subscription and annual subscription. So some people cancel out, some people sign up. But on an average, we have about 4,000 active subscribers. And what we've seen this year, very successful, is about 40,000 year over growth from last year. So you can see on this chart, these lines just, and it's been a very successful program for us. As far as lessons learned, I'd like to end with just giving you a quick recap on what lessons we've learned and what we are doing in the future. So one of the biggest things we've seen is an increase in customer support needs, right? So with an institution model, the librarian is the person all the users go to. So if they cannot have easy access to something, or if they need help with doing a search or whatever, the library is the place they go to, and we then hear from the librarians, and the librarian is then representing a big group of people. With individual access, that's not the case. Those individuals don't have a place to go to, so they pick up the phone and they call us directly. And that has increased dramatically. So we have a very small group of user support people of only 12, and two of them are dedicated just for this individual program. And just this year, we've seen, or over the last 2 years, we've seen about a 70% increase in those calls. And when we look at what those calls are, they're mostly administrative calls. They are things like, I forgot my password, or what is my username, or I didn't get my invoice, or can you send me an invoice? I mean, those are kinds of things we don't hear at the institution access level, because all of that is happening behind the scenes for the user. These are real questions and real things that we get calls for. So we have to spend time there, and that was one thing that I don't think we were expecting. It wasn't something we were prepared for. We also have seen increased marketing efforts, and this is by our choice. We have decided to up marketing efforts. You know, people sign up for this thing, and then it's need-based, and then they forget about it, they go away. So our marketing group reminds them when we see them not using it. We reach out to them, we remind them of the service that they're subscribing to so that they can come back and use it more. We have newsletters, we have surveys, we have a whole bunch of things the marketing group does to sort of remind people, but also to learn what's missing and what can we continue to develop and what can we learn so that we can develop this program further. And then just general research queries, you know, how-to kind of things. Again, in an institution environment, the library and the librarians are providing those services. In this environment, like, we've had to host webinars, we have training videos and so on and so forth on our site to point these users to and say that, okay, this is how you can use the services, this is what's in the service and so on and so forth. We are also, through this program, reaching new markets. If you remember, I said this is access for people that are not affiliated with an institution. Many, many users outside have research needs. They don't have to be academic focused. They don't have to be affiliated with an institution. And what we're finding is we are able to find these new areas. So a couple examples, local historians, authors, people writing fiction novels and things like that. We're finding those people coming and becoming subscribers to the JPASS program because they have a need to do some research as they're doing their work. We also have partnered with societies. Societies participate in the JSTOR program. They give their journals and content into the JSTOR platform. And we offer a discounted annual subscription to their members. And that program has been reasonably successful, and we want to grow that more. What we also have heard from users is flexible access options. You know, people want a very short amount of time. I mean, that's what led us to doing a monthly and an annual, because some people are very project-based. They have some research they want to do it for a month or two, and then they want to move on. So we created the monthly option and the annual option. What we've also found, or what we feel, is that price may be a barrier on people, more people signing up, and our goal is not really to make that much money. Of course, money is good, but we don't want to make that money. It's to improve access and to broaden the access. So right now we're running an experiment where we have half the price of the monthly and the annual subscription. That experiment's been going on for about 45 days now, and we've already seen about a 40 to 50% increase in the number of signups. So we are going to continue to run that program for another couple of months, and then with 3 months of data, we will go back and analyze that data and figure out if that is something we need to do on a more permanent basis. So that was the point of that first bullet there. But what we want to do next is really continue to engage with our users. Everything we do is to help and get value to our users, and we will continue to do that. It's the way we work. We engage with them, we learn from them, we observe their behavior, we observe their activities, and from that we understand what the unmet needs might be for these users, and then we want to develop solutions for them. So I mentioned the price change one. We also believe in tools, and we want to be developing more tools. This past 2 years, when we've developed the My List and the Outline Builder, we've seen the activity dramatically increase on our site, and we want to see more of that. So, you know, we believe that people want to collaborate between themselves, and we want to create tools that help two users collaborate between themselves and engage between themselves on our platform, and we can be the facilitator. So we have to think about what those tools look like and what we need to develop over there. JSTOR and ArtStore recently got together, so we now have more content assets. We have more than just journals. We have art, we have books, we have primary sources, we have research reports, all of those kinds of things. The JPass program right now is just for journals, so we want to see how we can expand that service to include other content types, not just in its silos, but also across it. So a researcher doing a research might have need for content. It doesn't matter what type of content it is, text-based, image-based, so on. So we want to try and group those together and leverage that. And then we want to continue and look at new markets. So, you know, a couple markets we found where are groups of people that have shown high interest. We believe that there is a corporate market that might value the content that we have and could access information through them. So we want to make that available. So we want to explore new markets there as well. So those are sort of quick summary of the programs that we have, what we have done so far, how well the programs are doing, and what we hope to be doing in the future this year. We don't think too far out. We look at, you know, 8 to 12 month windows, and these are all the activities that we hope to do within the next 8 to 12 months to sort of grow these programs even more. That's all I have. I'm happy to take questions, anything that you want to know. I'll try and answer them. If I cannot, I'll come back to you with some answers.